Getting to know yourself can be a lifelong process, especially since you're always growing and changing. Therapy is all about deepening that self-awareness, because sometimes you don't know what you really want until you talk things through. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist online who can take you on that journey of self-discovery from wherever you are. Visit betterhelp.com/positive today to get 10% off your first month. That's betterhelp.com/positive.
Hey, football fans, Baldy here, and I'm doing something special for this year's NFL Draft. Jason Locke and Four and I are hosting the 2023 Odyssey NFL Draft Show. Join us on the first night of the draft, talking with our local experts from across the Odyssey podcast throughout the country. And leading up to the draft, check out our podcast, In the Huddle. I'm giving you an inside scoop on the best prospects for your favorite team. And it all starts Thursday, April 27th at 7 p.m. Eastern until the first round ends, only on the free Odyssey app.
Jacob Albrocht, Tommy Caster. This is Sports Daily on Wichita's number one sports radio, 97.5 and 1240 KFH.
Welcome in, everybody. Hour number two here of Sports Daily. Jacob Albrocht, Paul Savage filling in for Tommy Caster this week. Glad to have you on board. Glad to have you be a part of this program always. And we are excited to have you here, whether you are listening to us on KFH or whether you are watching us now with our new video stream that is just getting cooking. We've got it a few places for you. Facebook on the KFH Facebook page, the KFH YouTube page. You can watch it there. You can comment with us live on the air. We'll put those up on the screen for people. You can also find it on Twitter on the Sports Daily KFH Facebook page. If you're listening to us or you're watching us, the IHOP hotline always open for you. 869-1240 is that number. We will have more giveaways to come. We've got some Wind Surge tickets to give away, perhaps. Maybe this week. We have today some Coheed and Cambria tickets to give away. That show is coming up on May 12th. We'll do that a little bit later in the program as well. Lots of good stuff. Glad to be here. Paul, it is a Monday. It is the Monday before the NFL draft. And the NFL draft just happens to be taking place right up the road in Kansas City. I know people are excited about this. You haven't been in since we've really started to talk draft. I think this is going to be a phenomenal NFL draft, intriguing NFL draft as far as entertainment value, because you've got a lot of quarterbacks in play. You don't have a lock and key, you know, first few picks like you have some years. I think there's a lot of questions about what will happen. We've seen trades to move around. I think we're going to see more trades before Thursday. And the team we follow, the Kansas City Chiefs, to me, Paul, is in a total position of power this year. You know, the last 2 years they came into the draft with great positions of need and some pressure. I don't think that exists for them this year. A lot to be excited about a few days away now here from round one of the NFL draft.
Well, I think you're probably right. Now, this is a great draft in a lot of ways, particularly with I think it's a really good draft with quarterbacks. I like all the quarterbacks that are in. Now, are they all perfect quarterbacks? No. All of them have a problem with this or with that, particularly when you look at what we all believe is going to be the first round draft pick in Bryce Young out of Alabama. You know, I've never been big on guys under 6 foot. You know that. This kid's 6 foot. I mean, he's 5'10", and I've always had a problem with that. But, you know, he's in the same vein as a Kyler Murray or a Hurts from Philly. I mean, you know, I get it. I understand. The kid is definitely a talented football player. Will he translate to the NFL? You know, I question whether the Carolina Panthers can base their entire essence and who they are and who they are going to become with Bryce Young. I don't know, but I certainly don't blame them for taking a chance. But a number one pick, you know, who knows? But, you know, there's a lot of things that we can follow on this draft. You know, it's interesting where we're getting down to in the world of the draft nowadays, and that's quarterbacks and pass rushers. Have you noticed that? It's now coming down to the fact teams really get how important it is to be able to pass rush and find those kids who can specialize in pass rush, whether it's push in the middle or whether it's rim runners. Either one. That's, you know, teams are really looking for those kind of kids. And you're going to have a ton of quarterbacks. You're going to have a ton of edge and push guys in the middle get drafted. And rightfully so. You want to change a franchise fast? Those are the two positions that can do it the quickest.
Well, you've got the quarterback, which is clearly
right.
The most important position. And then the position that probably has more to do with defending the quarterback than any other, which is the defensive pass rusher. There you go. I mean, that's it. That's where the money goes in this league. And then you get a lot of money paid to, you know, left tackles because they protect the quarterback, and wide receivers' value is increasing because they enhance the quarterback. So it's all about the quarterback in this league. And I don't disagree with it. I think it is fascinating. I love talking quarterbacks, and I think we've got all kinds of storylines, not just with Bryce Young, and I assume he's going to be the first pick too.
Right, I do too.
But what about the others? What happens with Trey Lance if the Niners decide to go with Brock Purdy? We still don't have an answer on Aaron Rodgers or Lamar Jackson, two of the top 10 quarterbacks in this league, both former MVPs. Where are they going to play football next year? We don't have that answer. I think between now and Thursday, this could get fascinating. And let's say nothing does happen with Rodgers and Jackson. That may make it even more fascinating, right? Because we don't know what's going to happen. What are the Jets going to do if they don't get Aaron Rodgers' deal done? And you know there's urgency to get these deals done because teams want the draft capital right now.
Right.
And so, you know, I don't know what to expect with any of this.
Right.
You know, is Lamar Jackson a potential trade candidate somewhere? Is he going to ever be able to come to agreement with Baltimore, who I think in their heart of hearts still wants him there? They just don't want to pay him all the guaranteed money. I don't know what to expect out of all that. But it just sort of lines up with this draft, which is already intriguing because you've got about five quarterbacks. And I think most people agree on the top two, Bryce Young and C.J. Stroud. But there's plenty of people that think one of the others, Richardson with his upside, Levis with his cannon of an arm, and then Hendon Hooker. I think that you've got five guys that all kinds of different opinions on and different rankings of those guys, and plenty of teams in this league need a quarterback, and you know who evaluates who and who's going to throw it all in. Carolina already did. They already pushed all their chips in. And so who is anybody else going to do that to go get one of these other guys? I mean, it's fascinating, Paul, and you know what? As we sit here now just a few days away, there are drafts where, you know, kind of everybody mocks them the same at the beginning. And you're like, yeah, we kind of know who the top four or five picks are going to be here. I don't think we even know who the top pick's going to be fully. And then after that, all bets are off. Everybody's in play at that point. Houston could make that pick. They could take a quarterback. There's reports that they don't like any of the quarterbacks besides Bryce Young. Do they trade? Who moves out? Like, it's going to be fascinating.
Well, Will Levis is a heck of a quarterback. I mean, he's got a lot of upside, at least in my opinion, and some of the others too. Now, here's the one thing that you said that I'm agreeing with you. Now, it's been a little bit since my services were needed, and I haven't been on the show recently, but a while back we were talking about Aaron Rodgers. We did a show not that long ago where I was just assuming that was a done deal. I mean, I had assumed that he was going to be signed, literally days, if not hours, after our conversation with regards to, you know, Aaron Rodgers going to the Jets. Still not done, though, is it? Last I checked, as of yesterday, still not done. We would certainly know about it if it was done sometime this morning. But we don't. That's stunning to me that the Jets haven't pulled the trigger on that to get where they need to go. So, yeah, that screws up everything. It makes it hard to project where these quarterbacks are going to go. And this is a class with some quarterbacks. It would not surprise me to see up to three quarterbacks start as first-year rookies for their NFL franchise. Won't surprise me. Would not shock me a lick. On the other hand, for all we know, this is the NFL. Maybe not a single one of them ends up being the starter his first year. Maybe they're going to expect somebody to learn and watch and adjust and understand the NFL game, because it is certainly different. I don't even care if you're at Alabama. The NFL is still a lot different than the University of Alabama, and Alabama would be as close as the NFL as you can get at the college level. But with that being said, it's going to be interesting. It won't surprise me to see edge and push rushers go in the top 10, maybe three, maybe four. Could be up to four, at least three pass rushers, and rightfully so. You got to expect it. You know it's coming. I get it. I would do the same thing. And that's where the Chiefs are going to need one more edge rusher, aren't they? I think the Chiefs are going to be looking at whatever's available. I believe, and I could be wrong on this, that it could be an edge rusher could be their first pick. May not be. It might be a receiver. But it wouldn't surprise me if it was going to be an edge rusher. If there's still one available for the Chiefs, I wouldn't be shocked if the Chiefs took an edge rusher. Would you?
No. I think their biggest needs are, and Tommy and I have talked about this. We'll see what you think, Paul. I think their biggest needs are edge rusher, offensive line, because now they got to replace the right side, right?
Right.
Cornerback, and wide receiver. And I think they could take any of those four positions in that pick. I think they can move up. I think they can move down. But I think those are the four positions of need. They've done such a good job in the last two drafts of addressing absolute necessities, which was 2 years ago the offensive line and last year the defense as a whole, that they've allowed themselves some freedom here in this draft to be really aggressive with whatever it is that they want, right? If they evaluate a player at one of those four spots, they can go get them. And there are other places you could see them draft. You know, at some point, you got to probably take a tight end. I don't think they're going to do it with early draft capital, but if they really like a player, maybe. I just think they've got freedom. But yeah, defensive line on the pass rush, offensive line on a right tackle, cornerback and wide receiver to me are the biggest areas of needs, and I could totally see them going any of those directions early on.
Well, I think you're exactly right. Now, we could become surprised. You know, the Chiefs are at a point now where also you could look at best player available. That wouldn't shock me either. But on the other hand, you know, there's some things that the Chiefs can use. I mean, you win a Super Bowl. You're thinking you're pretty solid. But, you know, you're always going to get older as you go along, and I just don't know. I like the idea of taking a pass rusher, but that's just me. That's the old D-line coach coming out in me. I like the idea of a pass rushers change the nature of a football game. To me, it's one of the most important things that you can do, and that is put pressure on the quarterback. That's to me where you got to be, and if you can do that, you got a lot of success. You know, Frank Clark's gone; he's no longer a part of the Kansas City Chiefs, and he was pretty good. He did a good job pass rushing and putting pressure on the quarterback, and you got to replace him. I think in the middle, of course, you've got on the other edge and in the middle, you're pretty solid. Boy, I'd like to see somebody take Frank Clark's, and I would like to see a two-sided edge rusher on both sides. And if you can find that guy, you have my permission to take him in the first round with the first pick. If you can find that guy, it's okay with me.
Yeah, I think I'd be – the only disappointment I would have is if they don't just trust their evaluation. I don't think that they're desperate anywhere.
What do you mean?
So
what do you mean?
I don't think they would reach. I don't want to see them reach on anybody.
Oh, I got you. I know, see.
Any,
yeah.
When I say reach, I mean by their own rankings,
I got
right?
You.
Like
if
Mel Kiper has a guy lower on his board than they, I don't care about that. I mean by their own rankings, I don't think that. Let me give you an example. Two years ago with offensive line, they had to take an offensive lineman. They had to take offensive lineman early in that draft. So they might have needed to reach on players that they maybe didn't evaluate that way. Now, they'd never tell you they did that, but they could have, and I would have been okay. Last year, anywhere on the defense, right? Like, I would have been fine reaching on some defensive players, even if there was a great offensive player sitting in their lap, because they had to have that in order to try to win a Super Bowl, and they did win a Super Bowl. This year, even with those positions of need, I don't view them as desperate. So when I say the only way I'd be disappointed is if they reach, it would be that if they feel like we have got to have a pass rusher here. And they pass on better players at other spots just to address that position. I don't think they need to do that. I don't think they will, but I don't think they need to do that. That would be where it would be a little disappointing to me. So as long as they're just trusting their own, you know, evaluators who have done such a good job in the last few drafts, and they just kind of let it play out a little bit. Or, Paul, if they look, if they love somebody, if they love a player, this is the year to move up and go get them. They've got the flexibility. They've got, you know, they don't have to hit on five picks in this draft. If they hit on one or two and one of them is an absolute stud, superstar-type player, I think that could be a successful draft for them because they did the retooling the last 2 years. You're always retooling in the NFL, but their level of retooling this year versus the last two to me is just far lower. So go get a star if you can find them, whether that falls in your lap or whether you trade some capital to go get it. And if you don't have it, trade back. I just don't reach on anything.
Right. You know, that's a really good point. And it's a point I haven't really thought about in a long, long time. And that is, let's say 10 years ago and back, it was a common phrase within radio, with what you and I do and what we talk about, best player available. That term was used a lot. Well, you don't hear that term all that often anymore, do you? Best player available. Oh, you hear it every once in a while. But you don't hear it the way you used to hear it. Best player available. But the Kansas City Chiefs are a unique football team. They can do some of that. They're able to do that a little more than, well, let's say than somebody who you know was horrible. I mean, they have the ability to go get the best player. And I like your take on that. You know, I'm kind of with you on that. I hadn't really thought of it in those terms, but I'm kind of with you on that. And if anybody can do it, it can be the Kansas City Chiefs. They can do it. But best player available, you know, I just hope the best player available is an edge rusher. I'm sorry, I just hope that's the case. But, yeah, I like your take on that, and I think you're right.
What do you think about wide receiver? So wide receiver is the position, I think, of the most drama and intrigue for the Chiefs because there's plenty to debate about it. So when we look at that spot in particular, they won a Super Bowl with the group they had last year. Now, I don't know that I think they have enough. They could have enough if Kadarius Toney stayed healthy and Sky Moore takes the steps we think he can take. There's a lot of risk there. I'm a believer that they could absolutely take an early wide receiver if they evaluate that one that way and that's a good use of that pick because I still think they need a little bit there. And I know that they got it done without a ton of production at wide receiver last year. But Travis Kelce ain't getting any younger. And if you've got an opportunity to go get receivers in this league, especially young ones, I think it's never been a better time to do it. So I'm fine with an early receiver. What do you think about wide receiver, Paul?
Well, let me ask you a question before I give you my answer because I'd like you to be a little more specific. What kind of wide receiver are you really wanting? If you had that pick, do you want that Tyree Hill type kind of receiver, or do you want that big, tall, lanky, you know, Terrell Owens type receiver, the big, tall, lanky guy that can run a go route or run a fade and go up and make a play? You know, what kind of let me be clear, what kind of receiver do you think would fit in best with the Kansas City Chiefs right now?
A big possession, probably.
Okay.
You know, I think that they've got twitchy guys. I think that I don't know, because they can do different things with guys more than any other team.
They can.
You know, Kadarius Toney is twitchy. You know, he's really good, but man, he's always hurt. Sky Moore, I like his upside. You know, Quentin Johnston gets mentioned from TCU. That sizey receiver makes some sense to me. But then I've seen them tied to Flowers from Boston College, whatever his name is. I see his video, and he's more like Hill, Hardman, you know, of that mold. I don't think it really matters for them because I think they just will design whatever they need to. I just think more options for Mahomes. It would a deep threat would be nice. Right? Because Marquez Valdez-Scantling is that, but he's pretty inconsistent. Travis Kelce gives you your safety blanket. He's the unicorn for them that allows them to be more creative, I think, with their wide receivers and how they use them, because Kelce is their, you know, go-to if you need a play, whatever it is, where most teams utilize a wide receiver to do that. So I don't think it really matters, because I think they can do different things with different receivers, probably more than any other team in football. So doesn't really matter to me. Only if a guy, if you evaluate them that way and they're a great player and you like them, I don't want to see them reach on a wide receiver, but if one is available to them, whether they could move up and get one because they love them or one falls in their lap, I'm to the point with them after the last couple of years where I just sort of trust their draft process, because they've gotten so many things right the last 2 years that it's like, okay. And I like Sky Moore. I know they spent some higher draft cap. I think he's going to be good. It's come along a little slower than I thought it might, but I still do think he'll be a good player. But if they take a twitchy, quick receiver again, which they've had so much success with, I'm good with it. If they take a big, you know, catch it over the middle, you know, break tackle, whatever, get contested ball kind of receiver, I'm good with that too. The other elephant in the room that we've talked about before is DeAndre Hopkins, who's been rumored with the Chiefs for a long time. You know, I don't know what his asking price. I don't know what the price tag on him would be from Arizona. If it's anything more than a second round pick, I'm probably out. I wouldn't give up a first. I'd probably still field the conversation if it was a second round pick. But DeAndre Hopkins, you know, fits what they need too, Paul. Whether, I know he's older. When he's healthy, he's been really good. But, you know, I guess it sort of depends, doesn't it, on how they view a receiver in the draft versus what they think Hopkins could give them. They may think they can get Hopkins-level production out of one of these players. I don't know.
Well, I think you're right. Now, and I like the way you're thinking on that, and that is, you know, let's face it, Travis Kelce gives you a lot of options. Travis Kelce is the closest thing to a Tariq Hill that's not Tariq Hill. I mean, that's that situation, because, you know, you've got to do things to cover – Travis Kelce. There's certain things you can do and you can't do on defenses, because he has such a unique ability to get open. He runs those great routes. He's so hard to cover, and he has the size, but they line him up where they put those small, fast guys. I mean, that's what you do with a Travis Kelce. Because of that, and because you have a Travis Kelce, you're going to get a lot more single coverage on any of the deep stuff. That's why I'm kind of like, and you can fault me if you can see a sense in where I'm going wrong. I kind of like taking that big, lanky, quick receiver who can run a fade, because, you know, as John Madden used to say, and he said it so well, three things happen on a fade. You catch the ball, you get a you catch the ball, or you get a pass interference, or an incompletion. So two out of the three are pretty good. Two out of the three are just fine for your football team. So that's why I'm big on fades. I'm big on a guy that can go get the ball. But that takes a guy with size. That takes a guy with 6'3", 6'4", 6'5".
It does, unless you've got a unicorn like Tyreek Hill. Well, because remember, what made Tyreek Hill great is he became one of the great deep ball catchers in football. Well, like adjusters and all those. Now, he could outrun everybody to get there.
That was just outrunning. That's not the
fade. I get what you, that's yeah, not the I know fade. What you're saying. Yep, which DeAndre Hopkins would be great for.
He would
right?
be good.
And that's the thing.
That's right.
Yeah, so, but he's older, and he's expensive. And so if you evaluate, I'm with you on that, Paul, because that's what they don't have right now. That's what they're lacking. However, they've also seen Tyreek Hill and Mecole Hardman go in the last, you know. So that also, it's not necessarily a position of need, because I think Kadarius Toney does a lot of that. But it's a position of, yeah, I'd be on board with that. I just think the Chiefs have so much flexibility in this draft that they can do about a billion things and be fine. And I'm excited to see what they do on Thursday, if anything. Remember, they could trade out of that pick too, which would be, I think, a little disappointing for the hometown fans, but who are going to pack the streets of Kansas City for this thing. It'll be fun. Hey, we got some tickets to see Coheed and Cambria at the Cotillion. That show's on Friday, May 12th, 7 o'clock. Special guest, Def Heaven. We'll give away some tickets to that, one pair right now to our first caller during the break. Chad will get us a winner as we roll forward. Jacob Albrock, Paul Savage, Sports Daily on a Monday. All right, welcome back, everybody. Sports Daily, all Brockton Savage. I appreciate you joining us, whether you're listening on KFH or watching us now on the KFH Facebook page, KFH YouTube page, or Sports Daily Twitter page. Lots of different ways to watch the show, lots of different ways to interact with the show. We are still sort of in our maiden voyage with this video stream, just scratching the surface. I'll call it our rough draft still, and we'll have a more, you know, official and polished launch here pretty soon. But we appreciate everybody jumping in with us as we're having some fun with it in these early stages. Paul in for Tommy all week here. Paul, good to have you.
Thanks.
On Sports Daily. It's been a while. Happy to have you here. It's you'll be, I know, busy as we enter the travel season, and we're moving around and jumping around and getting through everything. Paul, I've seen a lot of chatter right now about how bad the A's are. Now, the A's are moving to Vegas. I think they've made it abundantly clear. This roster is terrible, and they're not even trying to win, right? Those things all seem relatively established and understood, and it's a problem. The Royals are only one game better right now, which that stings, right? The Royals 5-17, Oakland 4-18. But if you think it's bad and you're a Royals fan, the run differential for Kansas City right now, Paul, is 51. They're 51 on the wrong side. Oakland is more than double that. Oakland is getting beat by an average of 5 runs a game. Oakland has very little on the roster to be excited about. All of those things aren't true for Kansas City, at least, right, Bobby Witt Jr.'s there and some of the young players, and we're wondering about some of the young pitchers and like all these things. And, you know, the Royals, for as bad as the record has been, the baseball has not been nearly as bad. And that's sort of, you know, as we look at it and we talk about Oakland and what this year might look like for them. There are teams that aren't winning a lot of games right now. Colorado, also in that mix, is only 6-17. Their run differential's only at 54. Oakland is getting beat by twice the margin that Kansas City and Colorado are getting beat right now. That is astounding on just how bad they appear to be.
Let me just throw a couple names out for you, if you don't mind, just to reminisce. Catfish Hunter, Reggie Jackson. You know, I could go on and name numerous, you know, great, great players that played for the Oakland A's. There's a tradition there. But right now they're so bad, nobody's going. And you know you have a problem. Here's my rule of thumb. This is a savagism. Any stadium that has to tarp off most of your seats, there's a problem there. And that's what the Oakland, at the stadium in which they play their baseball games, you know, the top level, and I know you know this, you've seen it probably 100 times, and it's been like this for years. They've tarped off the top section. That'd be like at Royal Stadium. You walk in, and there's tarps that cover the entire upper deck. That thing's tarped off. That's the way it is in Oakland. I don't blame them for moving. I don't blame them for going. There are literally games, and in fact, they've had a couple of games this year, where Jacob, my understanding is there's less than 1,000 people there. That can't be. This is Major League Baseball. I don't blame the A's for leaving. I think they probably would have been wise to do it years ago. But moving's a tough thing. You're going to get criticized. You want to move a franchise out of a place where you've been for years and years and years, then that's what you do. But building a new stadium is not the answer, is it, Jacob? Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe a new stadium will be the savior, and people will go. But will they go and watch this kind of baseball? And we all have seen the movie with Brad Pitt in it. What is that?
Moneyball.
We've all seen Moneyball. Mm-hmm. Moneyball is a fun movie. I really enjoyed
it.
Great movie.
Yeah.
Brad Pitt did a great job. But the story has some truth. It has, obviously, some Hollywood in it. But there's a little bit of truth in that. They don't want to spend money on players. You know, remember the conversation? Brad Pitt walks in and says, as Billy Bean, and says, I got to talk to you. We need money. You want to win, we got to get some money. We got to build our – we don't have that money. Owner says, no, we're not going to do it. And that's where Oakland is. But you go to Las Vegas. They've bought the land, evidently. And it's been so long since I've been to Vegas, I'm not sure where this would be, but it's not far off the strip. My understanding is a block or two off the strip. Well, that'd make for pretty expensive land, I'm guessing. But 43 acres to build a stadium. Go to Las Vegas. Jacob, I don't blame them. I mean, even with the history and the tradition that you have, the great players who have come and gone from the Oakland franchise, I do not blame Oakland or the owners of the Oakland A's for making a change and going to Las Vegas. In fact, I'm of the opinion the sooner the better. Go ahead and get the stadium built and let's go. There's a lot of activity in Southern Nevada. It's a place to be. You now have an NFL franchise. You now have an NHL franchise. It certainly makes sense. Major League Baseball would be not far behind, probably followed by NBA basketball. We all know that that's a basketball nut town. People love UNLV, always have loved UNLV, still support UNLV. It's a basketball town. It will not surprise me within the next decade that Las Vegas has all four of the major franchises. So there you go. I mean, I don't know if that was what your question was, but, man, Jacob, I don't blame them for wanting to move to Las Vegas. Can't blame them. Don't blame them.
Well, listen, how do you expect fans to show up when you don't ever field a team? Paul, every great player they have, they trade.
Yeah.
You blame the fans for not supporting this franchise?
No, but which comes first, the chicken or the egg? Which comes first?
They've had great years, and they won't do anything to sustain that success. Like, at some point, there has to be accountability for these small market teams to at least try to win, right? Like, we see this all the time. For every great story, like San Diego, who has just spent like crazy since they're making this push, the Royals tried to spend once they, you know, got some players, and it probably hurt them a little bit. There's plenty of franchises that don't ever spend. Cleveland, right? Cincinnati, Oakland, like they don't, it's like they're not even trying. This cycle of, you know, whatever it is, because they get lots of money in revenue sharing. Like, I'd love to see profit margins for some of these teams. And Tampa is the outlier because they're so good at this, but I don't blame their fans for not showing up either because they never know who these players are. Now, Tampa's been able to keep some guys better than like Oakland has, but no. This chicken or the egg, like, if you're not committed to winning, why should the fans show up? And Oakland, to me, has felt like for a long time they've had their foot out the door. Now, with, you know, the Bay Area having two teams, maybe it was just never going to work. So, no, I don't blame Oakland for not ponying up for a new stadium when the team won't commit to winning. Well, Kansas City will be an interesting case study because I think that Kansas City's payroll is not at the bottom of the league, by the way. And when they were, you know, their problem is they haven't been any good at the baseball part of it. But I don't question their desire to win. I don't question their desire to, you know, spend money for a competitive team. I think the desire's there. I just think they've been really bad at it. Oakland, for a lot of years, has been really good at it. But then they don't commit to keeping players and keeping the winning up and rewarding fans for showing up. They do everything they can to cut every penny they can, and I just don't care about that. Like, go to Vegas, and I hope it changes, but it's going to be a good fit there, I think. But, you know, I see them going to Vegas, and they do all this stuff. Are they going to all of a sudden is the same ownership group, Paul, going to spend more money on the roster now?
They'll be making more money.
I don't know.
Well, they're going to make more money. I mean, you go to Las Vegas, you're going to have better attendance. You're going to have more money coming in. And the opportunities for corporate sponsorships will be unbelievably different compared to the city of Oakland. I mean, come on. Oakland right now is a city that's you know, really struggling as a city, as we all know. And now you're sitting there competing with another team just across the bridge. That's all it is, just across the bridge, not very far. And you're competing with them. You won't have the competition of the San Francisco franchise there in Las Vegas. You're going to be the only one, but you're competing with a sister franchise in essence in the city of San Francisco and Oakland. They're almost attached, so no competition. More revenue, more corporate sponsorships opportunity. To me, this is just very simply a situation where things will be better in Vegas. Yes, they will spend more money on players in Las Vegas than they're spending on the Oakland A's. Because in Oakland, you're just wasting your money because you could spend a ton of money. You get these players, they mature, you start to pay them, and all of a sudden you're losing money. I don't blame an owner.
You're not losing money, Paul. Okay, so I'm going to here and bear with me. So according to Statista.com,
okay,
and these are numbers from 2021. These are revenues by the team, right? Revenues by the team, again, according to Statista. I'm going to compare that to SportTrack, which follows closely payroll numbers of 2021. Okay? So Oakland's payroll in 2021, according to SportTrack, was $90 million. And according to Statista, who tracks business stuff, their revenue in 2021 was $208 million. Okay? $208 million, they spent 90 on their roster.
Well, wait a second.
Okay.
You know, you got overhead, Jacob. You know, you have you ever heard of overhead?
I do. I own two businesses. I know all about overhead.
Okay.
I do.
Well, you say they're not probably making a ton of money, by the way, because there's a lot of other expenses that go into running a baseball team than just payroll. Oh, by the way, do you mind if I ask one real quick question? Look at the Giants for me, the San Francisco Giants. Would you look at and see what is their payroll? We say it's $90 million for the A's. Do you have the Giants?
Yeah, their payroll.
Yeah.
In 2021, which was the year, because Oakland's this year is now. Okay. I'm going to tell you that describe. I just didn't have the revenue numbers.
Oh, I got you.
So
okay.
Hang on. In 2023, let me update my sheet here. We have the Mets at the top at $345 million. We knew their spending spree. So the Giants have spent $184 million on their roster. Oakland has spent 60.
Oh, my gosh. 60. That's three times. So what do you expect in terms of a performance? I mean, you know, just what do you expect with regards to a five-run spread between for losses with regards to that aspect of baseball? I mean, you got to spend some money. I mean, you're getting spent 3-1 by the Giants, and they're what, a hop, skip, and a jump over the bridge away?
Right.
Come on.
And that's the thing.
Come
like,
on.
And I get it. The ballpark isn't the best. But I just don't think you can ask if you have this long track record of doing this. I just don't know how you ask like taxpayers to pay for this stadium. Like, if you want this to be a money-making venture and you think a new stadium is going to help you make money, then by all means, build a new stadium. But you're not showing us that you're committed to winning games. The Royals, who are going to have a tough time with this because they're not winning games, at least in recent history, has showed us they're trying to, right? When the roster was good, they spent a lot of money. And they're still spending decent money. They're just not very good. And so, like, I think it's different sometimes when these teams want to do these things. And if Oakland will go to Vegas and they get their new stadium and they actually spend on the roster, okay, fine. I'm okay with that. Like, if it wasn't a good fit, and I'm not sure that it was, because I think the Giants are just a much, much, much bigger deal in the Bay Area, then that's fine, right? Like, go to Vegas and be successful. I have no problem with that. But don't cry foul when the fans aren't showing up. You're not giving them anything to show up for.
Well, that's for sure.
This team's knocking on the door of being the worst team ever, which is wild. And we're only a month in. It's that run differential that is staggering, twice as bad as the Royals and Rockies, who are the two other worst teams in baseball a month into the season. 869-1240 is the number to call. Paul and I will be back. More Sports Daily right after this.
A little focus goes a long way, and a whole lot of focus, well, that puts you light years ahead of the competition. That's why at Vernon, they only focus on heating and cooling. And as the heating and cooling specialists, they're great at it, especially after 43 years. Get your AC ready for summer with Vernon's $69 spring tune-up. You heard right, only $69. Go to vernonheating.com. Vernon, the heating and cooling specialists.
It's time to get back to the sports talk.
All right, let's do this thing. Go!
Sports Daily is on KFH.
Welcome back, everybody. Sports Daily, KFH. Paul, quickly before we get out of here on a Monday, let's talk a little NBA playoffs.
Oh,
They've been pretty good here in the first round. Some high-quality games. One in particular yesterday is the Warriors survive this Kings onslaught and even up that series. That, to me, is the best first-round series. Lakers-Grizzlies has been pretty good, though. You got a little don't poke the bear deal going with LeBron James. I kind of liked it. I thought it was fun. you know, that Mills gave a little heat to LeBron James. I think that adds a little intrigue to the series. I got no problem with a young guy doing that, but you don't think they should be messing with LeBron.
Well, he's still got some ability and the way it looks.
Yeah, he's still pretty good.
We, you know, Dylan Brooks gave a new meaning to poke the bear, if you remember my
Mills, yeah, Brooks.
Yeah, so. Yeah, but I mean he kind of gave a new way of framing poke the bear, if you get my drift, you know, down to where no man likes to be poked, if you get my drift. But the fact is, Dylan Brooks did not get suspended. Just came out, I believe, yesterday, maybe last night, that he would not be suspended for that hit to the man region for LeBron James. A little surprised at that. You know, you're going to suspend Draymond Green, and I suspect you would need to suspend Dylan Brooks. That looks a little one-sided to me. But I guess with that being said,
They suspended Green for a game.
Well, but I mean one game, and you know they still ended up winning that game, which is interesting. And now San Francisco looks like they're going to win that series.
He was ejected from a game last year.
Yeah.
But he broke Gary Payton's arm. He was ejected in a game earlier this season for hitting Donovan Mitchell in the groin. So, you know, if you got a history of groin shots, I think you lose a little bit of benefit of the doubt there.
Yeah. Well, he should have been suspended for a second game or an entire game the very next game if you're going to do that to Draymond Green. But just to get back to the playoffs, this has been a playoffs. I've really enjoyed these playoffs. I think there's been some great matchups.
Too.
I really have enjoyed it. For an early first round, there's been some really great contests. There's a lot of competition going on. I've also enjoyed, for instance, the Suns and the way that they're playing, and the fact that you got KD now playing for the Suns. That's been a lot of fun to watch. I wasn't so sure that the Suns would end up winning, but it looks like they probably will that series. You've got numerous others that have really been entertaining and enjoyable. Have not enjoyed the Celtics in Atlanta for some reason.
That series wasn't going to be good.
It wasn't going to be good. I'm not sure the matchups are great. That series has left me a little on the – well, it's not must-watch TV for me, I'll put it that way. I do not need to watch.
Nuggets-Timberwolves. Nuggets-Timberwolves also isn't good, yeah. But everything else is.
Everything else has been
pretty good.
That's right. And particularly the Lakers, you know, a number 7 seed taking on the number 1 seed in Memphis. Now, remember, let's not forget Ja Morant, who, as you know, I think might be the best player in all of basketball. I mean, he's
been going through some stuff.
He's going through some stuff that I don't like. That's distracting. That alters his image. And I think he had a great image coming into the NBA. I'm not crazy about what he's doing. It appears to me just watching from afar, watching from Wichita, Kansas. You know, this fame and fortune seems to be going to his head a little bit. I'm not crazy about that, but there's still time to adjust and you know, save a reputation, and he can do that. But let's face it, he might be the most exciting, you know, basketball player on the court in the entire NBA Finals. But that's a fascinating series. The number 1 seed versus the number 1 seed. And right now it looks like the number 7 seed, the Los Angeles Lakers, are going to probably advance. I think there's a good chance they advance. So
I think they will too.
Oh, maybe tomorrow we'll get a little more in depth with regards
to
the NBA Finals.
Yeah, we'll hit the playoffs a little harder tomorrow. We got another Lakers game tonight. By the way, we just got these in. We've got some movie tickets for you, Boulevard Theaters, Town West. We always appreciate them hooking us up here and being a partner with us. So, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, we've got a Thursday, May 4th sneak peek. We'll give away some tickets here. Jad will get us our final winner, and we'll come back and tell you what's on tap today on the network.